I will deal with a case study on one country in East Central Europe, which was left out in the presentation up till now, which suffered severe damages during the war. This is Hungary. And I will focus on the case of reconstruction historical buildings connected with the Hungarian monarchs in the aftermath of the communist takeover. The most prominent complex will be in the focus of my presentation, and this is the Royal Castle in Buda, which due to its elevated position above the area of Buda itself and about the Danube, this castle hill, the so-called castle hill, had been ever since the Middle Ages a place of utmost strategic importance, and as such witnessed a lot of sieges, waves of destruction, followed by waves of reconstructions. These events and the fact that rulers and high officials of different origin and religious affiliation had their residences on the castle hill shaped the palimpsest of different symbolical layers. Given the fact that this complicated history of the place, 500 years, which is relevant for the discussions of the reconstructions that will follow, I will first give you a brief introduction in the, let's say, the most relevant historical facts connected, which are of utmost importance for the discussion of the reconstruction project. So the first period, which is of great importance, is the, in fact, the 15th century, with the building activities of two rulers. This is one, Sigismund of Luxembourg, who was Hungarian king and later on elected as emperor of the Holy Roman Empire, who started in the 1410-1420s to build up his main residence as emperor and build up a Gothic palace complex, which was enlarged later in the second half of the 15th century by Matthias Corvinus, and not only a Gothic palace, like to see it here in this city view in the Schedel World Chronicle, but also a palace in which he introduced elements of Italian Renaissance origin. And maybe one of, let's say, a mythical part of this complex was the famous Bibliotheca Corviniana, which was based in one room with a gilded ceiling. These buildings and institutions were developed further by the two successors of Corvinus, which were members of the Polish-Lithuanian dynasty of the Jagiellonians. In 1541, following the disastrous defeat of the Hungarian army at Mohács, Buda became the seat of a pasha. For nearly two centuries, the residence on Castle Hill was the foremost western administrative center of the Ottoman Empire. This situation changed dramatically after the siege of Buda by the coalition forces under Habsburg command in 1686. The siege put an end to the Ottoman occupation in Hungary and brought massive destruction for the whole area of the Buda Hill. The Habsburgs, who since the middle of the 16th century had also been kings of Hungary, started to build a palace on the top of the hill after having removed the greatest part of the damaged structures of the previous residence complexes and fortification. The first palace was built by Emperor Charles IV, and who never, in fact, used this residence, and was replaced later by a complex built by the Empress Maria Theresia. The new complex was used only sporadically, and under these circumstances, it was decided that the University of Nagysomba, this is Trnava in Slovakia, should be moved here. And in this context, a part of the building was a new kind of tower for astronomical observations was built, which will become very important in the discussions about the reconstructions. After a brief period, the university moved into the city, and the enlightened Emperor Joseph II appointed his younger brothers, the archdukes, starting with Joseph II, the archdukes resided as the Palatines of Hungary in this palace. So it was a kind of representative function connected with the monarchy of the dynasty of the Habsburgs located in this area. And probably this location of the Habsburg monarchs were also explained why the castle became the target of the revolutionary actions in 1848, 1849, and was seriously damaged. In the following period, 1850s, we are entering now the period of the long reign of Franz Josef, who shaped this area. We have a first complex that was built between 1850 and 1856 by two architects, Weiss and Neuwirth, which in fact was a kind of version of the classical Baroque of the of Viennese model with a dominant 13-axis central wing, and which always already had this kind of an attic tower at the top. The emperor visited this palace several times, and especially important was the visit after the conclusion of the Austro-Hungarian Compromise in 1867, followed by the crowning as Hungarian king, which took place on Castle Hill. And the palace from now on played a very important role in ceremonies and was interpreted as a symbol of the peace between the dynasty and the Hungarian nation. In the last decades of the 19th century, Budapest, now the second capital of the empire, faced a very rapid economic development. Ambition of urbanistic projects were carried out to express the growing wealth of and the new status of this capital. The autonomous Hungarian government intended to create a royal palace to match with any famous European royal residence, and especially the rivalry with the Vienna Hofburg, which just at that time was remodeled according to the plans of Gottfried Semper. The rebuilding of the complex spanned for over 40 years between 1878 and 1912 and changed the topography of the area entirely. It was planned first. The first phase of planning was started by Miklós Ybl, who was also responsible for the building of the parliament in Budapest. And his idea was to this was the original structure, which had been doubled by another very monumental building, which is on immense superstructures built. And he doubled it also in this in western direction, and at the junction of these two wings he placed what was a kind of tower, and that was kind of the point of view of this whole project. You see it here, and the tower was marked from the outside with a replica of the Hungarian crown on it. And beneath the this, in fact, is a fake dome. The so-called Habsburg Hall was placed, which was a room decorated with elaborate fresco program glorifying the Habsburgs as Hungarian rulers. This function was kept even later on, after the end of the Habsburg monarchy. The autocratic ruler Miklós Horthy took residence in the after 1980, in fact from 1920 till 1944 he resided there, and he was very influential and was also stressing in his propaganda the connection to Matthias Corvinus, and not only in the banknotes you see this connection, the palace and the portrait of the king, but also in the interior decoration. He commissioned a series of rooms like the so-called Hunyadi room and the so-called Corvinus library, which is not a room in a Renaissance style, but it alludes to the Corvinus library, which is in this period of time a very important issue, because Hungary is getting close to fascist Italy in diplomatic relations, and Mussolini is giving back some of the Corvinus manuscripts to Hungary. So we have also this external political connection in between. In fact, Horthy was forced to leave on the 16th of October 1944, when a Nazi German commando unit occupied the royal palace and forced him to abdicate. The Buda Castle was the last major stronghold held by Hungarian and German forces during the siege of Budapest. The siege lasted from December 1944 till February 1945, and it was one of the longest battles in Central Europe, with an enormous death toll and material losses, as you see here, the famous chain bridge, and in the background, the building of the palace, which was severely damaged. But we cannot show you some images in the great ballroom in a situation, and now a view from the roof, from the cupola. So we cannot say exactly how dramatically it was affected, because we do not have records, and the only documents for reconstruction, the scale of the damage, are photographs which are not dated. So let's say in the discussion, one point is that only the roof and the two uppermost stories were destroyed very badly. What had even more complicated the whole situation was that the roof was missing for more than 1.5 years. And so the water damages were very, very high in this area, and especially the interior of this of the whole wings were kind of destroyed. But the even before the communist takeover, first initiatives to deal with this situation were started, and one of the first let's say sketches about the future form of this building was developed by Ivan Kocsis, who was in fact a student of Alois Hausmann, who built the previous historicist building. And he is proposing, in fact, remaining at the scale of the building, but the only new element is this central tower, which replaces the faked dome of the first version. This is a clearly allusion to the astronomical tower of the university of the from the Maria Theresien time, and has also something to do with its orientation towards a period in the development of the Hungarian architecture, which was let's say late Baroque, early Classicism, which was regarded as a period in which Hungary had an autonomous architectural development with regard with respect to Vienna, and this was quite positively interpreted. The second point in the development of the of the reconstruction sets in the period in the years 1946 till 1948. Already some excavations in this area started, and we have the situation changes in 1949. Shortly after seizing power in autumn 1949, the communist rulers decided to turn the palace into the headquarters of the party and the seat of government. Its isolated and yet dominant position over the city held out the prospect of effective control, coupled with the security and in case of troubled times. And the restoration of the palace was enshrined as an important objective in the first 5 years plan. Under the new regime, also a wave of nationalization of land property started. In the following period, large scale of archaeological excavation started all over the country, and a combination of these two developments, the destruction of large historical areas and the abolishment of private land property, certainly opened unique possibilities for the researchers. Under these circumstances, archaeology became a kind of leading discipline within the Board of Monument Protection. In the case of the Buda Castle, the modern gardens in the south of the palace were deliberately pulled down. These were the historicist gardens that were still standing in a quite good position, but it was the deliberate will of the board to tear them down in order to look for the late Gothic, medieval, or Corvinian structures. Matthias Corvinus became interesting for the new rulers because of his role as a patron of humanism, and even more due to his rivalry to the Habsburg rulers. The works on the southern slope of Castle Hill were conducted by Karlmann Lux and the architects Laszlo Gerevich and Laszlo Gerő. And Laszlo Gerő put out two comments in 1915, which are worth quoting. First, he declared, I quote, "We have been waiting for the awakening of an aesthetic image unknown to us that had disappeared for 300 years. This is the awakening of the Hythaho dormant medieval castle." And even more pregnant, his statement in the newspaper Nebsauer, that means the people's voice, I quote, "The siege has peeled off the lies of the castle. The siege has removed the deceptive neo-baroque, neoclassicism, and even the Biedermeier style. The visible skeleton is the Gothic of the Middle Ages," unquote. So it was the firm view of Gerő that the socially progressive styles should be brought to light through the work of conservation again. The Middle Ages should therefore replace the what he called imperialist era. This aim was realized partially in the southern slope of the hill, where structures from the, let's say, late Gothic and early Renaissance were unearthed, and which were restored in a very bizarre mixture, in fact, of exact study of the unearthed fragments and some speculative reconstruction. And the speculative part of the reconstruction is connected to this part here, which was remodeled after the engraving we have from 1686, which is, we do not know how authentic it is, but it was taken as for face value. And one important detail is the road you see here in this. So this was planned as a kind of escape route for the road for the party chiefs, and was these medieval reconstructed towers also had a concrete control function for the actual party leaders, and the road was connecting the Castle Hill with an atomic bunker in the tunnel near the chain bridge. So the second part of the reconstruction was based on very detailed analysis of the structures, archaeological structures that were found, which were rebuilt in a kind of anastilosis, and we have these models like the lower chapel, and which were in fact taking up a program or a strategy of reconstruction which was practiced in the 1930s in Esztergom. The next point was in the 1950s, the debate was like monopolized by the party chief, Rákosi, who interfered very openly in these discussions. And the team of architects was changed. István Janáky and János Szilágyi were put in charge of the project. And again, it was the discussion of building this center. The discussion was focused mainly on this central element of the tower. And the whole discussion from now on is very closely related also to the fights between the internal factions of the Communist Party, which in their way are related to their position to Moscow. So this is an indirect influence coming from Moscow through these factions in Hungary. And these projects first were articulated and argumented in connection to this Hungarian tradition, like the late Baroque, early Classicism, beside the observatory of the university in the castle. We have another example from Eger, which was always quoted as a kind of signum of a national architecture. And only to show you the panorama, Rákosi was in one way interested to reconstruct the palace, but in the meantime, he authorized the demolishing of buildings like the Church of Mary Magdalene, which is also in the castle district placed, and even more radical, he gave the order of to demolish the church, which was designed by István Kocsiska, who was one of the architects involved in the planning of the reconstruction in order to build this Stalinism square. So in the 51-52, we also, 52, we have a visit of an delegation coming from Poland, headed by Zachwatowicz, who are arguing in favor of reconstructing the central dome of this building. In the meantime, also a change of cultural policy in Hungary took place in Hungary, and they were forced to, let's say, to get close to the line of the social realism, and this was done by quoting in this central part an element which was a part of the Hungarian classicism tradition, the cathedral in Esztergom, which was a kind of a very positively connotated building. So in the development, it started as a, let's say, going back to the Baroque origins, and it reached the classicism of Hungarian buildings, which were not secular buildings, as points of orientation. In the meantime, we had different factions trying to get influence, and in the end, in the aftermath of the revolution of 1956, the faction around Janusz Kadar is getting more and more influential, and backed by a group, they start arguing to rebuild or to reuse the castle as a cultural center. So that was the moment in 1957, first articles appeared in which it was they were warning that the location of the presidency in this building could further the cult of personality. Instead, it was one solution proposed was that the castle should be a castle of culture. And in 1959, finally, when Kadar secured his power, they, a change of plan took place, and they decided to locate cultural institution inside of this building. And this was the National Library, then the Budapest Museum, the National Gallery, but still the open question was not solved. The problem of the dome, which was only in 61, they started rebuilding it. And in fact, it's very interesting that it is a much taller construction than the initial dome built by Hausmann. And instead of the former Habsburg room, they built a monumental stairway. And this monumental stairway, in fact, destroyed part of the former church of the of the castle hill. And the modeling of the of this dome is very interesting, that they went back to a Roman early Baroque cupola of San Andrea della Valle in the form, in the exterior form, but in the interior it is an modern construction, cast iron. And in 1968, in fact, Kadar admitted himself in an internal conference that it was a big mistake, and the decision to locate this cultural institution was taken too hastily, and therefore he proposed to cut down or to lower the level of funding of this institution. Therefore, the whole process of finalizing these institutions within the Castle Hill took until 1985. It was nearly until the end of the communist period. And what was realized, in fact, is what we see now in Castle Hill is a very good, sample of the Hungarian architecture, modern architecture in the interior of the 1970s and 1980s. I show you here the entrance hall of the National Gallery. One of the wings was planned as the great the museum of the Hungarian Workers' Party, or the National Library in the Krisztina Város building of this thing. So it is in fact one 1989 was only one stop on the road after a period of reorientation. And some new functions were allocated in the, like the Museum of the Workers' Party was used for the collection of modern art of the Ludwig collection. Now, and this is a very new photo in 240, they're starting again with the reconstruction of the part of the Castle Hill connecting the Danube, which was in fact part of the planning of the 1870s, and the discussion about the use of this whole complex has started again, picking up arguments which were criticized, or the critique of János Kádár from the 1968. So the discussion about the reconstruction on the Castle Hill of Buda is still an open question. Thank you.